Good morning, everyone. Good morning, good morning, good morning, good morning. Welcome to Christ for the Nations and welcome to the memorial service for Dr. Delp. The family will be coming in the next minute or so, so they're asking if you all can be seated, please. Thank you so much. We appreciate it. And again, thank you for being here. Let's just wait for the family.
Show. family is just here to, my job is to welcome you guys this morning and thank you for coming. You know, death's a very unnatural thing. And although it's a part of our daily life, the reason we grieve and we mourn is because we were never really built to die. We were built to live. And so my dad lived a great life. And he was a champion all the way through to the end. So with the deepest, deepest sensations of our heart, just wanted to say thank you today for coming and celebrating us and our father. Aunt Carol found this morning and asked me to send it or to read it to you. It says, "When tomorrow starts without me, please try to understand that an angel came and called my name and took me by the hand. The angel said my place was ready in heaven far above, and that I'd have to leave behind all those I dearly love. But when I walked through heaven's gates, I felt so much at home. For God looked down and smiled at me and told me, welcome home. So when tomorrow starts without me, don't think we're far apart. For every time you think of me, I'm right there in your heart." You know, oftentimes we picture heaven being up and hell being down, but it's not a vertical reality. It's a dimensional reality, meaning that heaven is here with us. The kingdom's in our hearts. And so I don't think Dad's looking down as much as he's looking with. And I just wanted to say thanks on his behalf and my mama's behalf that you guys have come today and celebrate him. I'm going to introduce our first person. His name's Dale Forbes. He's a pastor in North Carolina. It's my dad's nephew, and he's going to be singing a song.
The city paved with gold. My mind can't conceive what my eyes now behold. The beauty and the splendor, the sparkling jewels so rare. All the riches of this world could never compare. Over there's my granddad, whom I haven't seen in years. And over there's that little boy I knew. I can't hold back the tears. Oh, look, there's Paul and Silas. There's John and Abraham. I have so many questions. Just where will I begin? Oh, but wait, a crowd is gathering, and I think I see His throne. Oh yes, it's Him, it's Jesus. Oh, now I know raised. The sweetest joy now floods my soul, and my hands lift up in praise to behold the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Behold the great I Am in all His splendor. Behold Almighty God, let heaven see me. Behold
I'm Mason, I'm the grandson. I don't really think this would be proper to do, knowing Papa, without worship. So that's what we're going to do. Y'all are free to sit, to think, to stand, lift your hands, do whatever you need to do. Just going to sit with Jesus for a little bit.
I love you, Lord. Oh, your mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up till I lay my head, I will sing of the goodness of God. And all my life you have been faithful. And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am, and I will sing of the goodness of God. I love your voice. You have led me through the fire. Darkest nights, you are close like no other. Known you as a father, I've known you as a friend, and I have lived in the goodness of God. And all my life you have been faithful, yes you have, yeah, yeah. All my life you have been so, so good. I will sing of the goodness of God. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life laid down, I surrender now, I give you everything.
Jesus is running after, is running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life laid down, I surrender now, I give you everything. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. All my life you have been faithful. And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, yes, I will sing of the goodness of God. I will sing of the goodness of God. I will sing of the goodness of God. You're so faithful, Lord. Come on, just bless him. Bless his name. Who is like you, King? In death and in life, you were faithful. Your faithfulness, Lord. Oh, we don't mourn like others. We have a faithful God on our side. Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not thy compassions, they fail not. Thou forever will be. Great is thy faithfulness. Great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Summer and winter and springtime and harvest, sun, moon, stars in their courses above, join with all nature in manifold witness to thy great faithfulness, mercy and love. Great thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness, morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand has provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto thee. thine own dear presence to cheer and to guide. Strength for today and a hope for tomorrow. Blessings all mine with 10,000 beside. Great is thy faithfulness. Great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand has provided. Great is thy faithfulness. Great is thy faithfulness. Great is thy faithfulness. Unstoppable faithfulness, unstoppable faithfulness.
And as you speak, 100 billion failures disappear. Lost your life so I could find it. If you left the grave behind you so alive, I can see your heart and everything you've done. Every part designed in a work of art. If you gladly chose surrender, so
like you would,
like you would again 100 billion times. But what measure could amount to your design? You left the grave behind you so alive. If you left the grave behind you so will, so will I.
You can be seated. So I'm actually going to do one more song. This is something Dad asked me to play, and I think it's very, very apt.
Was a giant, and I was just a kid that was always trying to do everything he did, and I can still remember every lesson he taught me, growing up, learning how to be like my old man. A lion. father's pride, but I was defiant. When he made me walk the line, he knew how to lift me up and when to let me fall. Looking back, he always had a plan. My old man, see the tattoo on his hand, sweatpants and button-ups. My old man, and now I finally understand, I have a lot to learn from my old man.
Well, I get to talk about my dad today. And dear Lord, there's so many things I could say. But first, I need to read the obituary in my phone. Stephen, I left down there again. So, this is going to sound a lot prettier than what I would say. So, to give his justice due. Dr. Randy Lee Delp was a passionate, loving, and kind husband, father, grandfather, brother, son, and friend. He left this world June 7th, 2022, at the age of 72 in Cedar Hill, Texas. After a serious battle with cancer over the past year, he showed us his courage in facing life's challenges with a smile. Despite the pain, he always tried to encourage others. As always, he came out a hero and stayed strong until the end. Surrounded by his loved ones, he will continue to honor his legacy by living their lives to the fullest and serving the kingdom with the same passion and vigor he had. He was born to Raymond and Chloe Delp on January the 11th, 1950, in Odd, West Virginia. After graduating from high school, he went on to attend Lee University to follow the call of God that was placed on his life and to go into the ministry. And while at Lee, he once again re-met with my mom, Mary, Terry, and married the love of, that's a Jesus complex. While at Lee, he met and married the love of his life, Terry Renee Workman. Together, they had one child, me. Aside from being an incredible husband, father, and grandfather, he served Christ for the nation selflessly and sacrificially in different roles and capacities with a spirit of excellence, a heart of humility, and a deep sense of loyalty. His most recent roles were Director of International Ministries, member of the CFNI Association of Bible Schools Advisory Council, and the CFNI's board parliamentarian. Throughout his 30-plus years of service to Christ for the Nations, Randy worked as a business director, HR director, dean of students 3 different times, faculty member since 1983, and served as the member of CFNI's President's Council. He helped establish the third-year school of missions in 1993, and he also established CFNI's third-year school of pastoral ministry in 1995. Randy traveled to many nations and represented CFNI as an ambassador. Randy served as the founding director of Caribbean Christ for the Nations in Jamaica in 1987 and as the director and advisor of Christ for the Nations in Japan. He was most recent chairman of Emmanuel Caribbean University in Jamaica. And founding presbyter of Caribbean Christ for the Nations Fellowship of Ministries, Ministers and Churches. He also served as a pastor for 12 years in West Virginia and helped pioneer churches in Minnesota and in Florida. Randy was an exceptional human being whose core desire was to extend the kingdom of God. That's the truth. Our beloved Randy is survived by his wife of 53 years, Terry Renee Delp, his son Kevin Lee Delp, his mother Chloe Delp, his grandchildren Mason Lee Delp and Reagan Christine Delp, his siblings, Carol, husband, and husband Gerald Winnington, Gail and husband Phil Tovin, Vicky and husband Michael Neal Sr., as well as numerous nieces and nephews and their families. The family would like to personally, that's not a part of it. Anyway, so, one of my first memories of being here at CFNI, I was 10 when we moved, and you know how, you know, you're raised in church and you're a temple brat, right? You get saved over and over and over and over and over again. And so so I was there, it was Sunday, and we had Sunday afternoon church, which messed with the Dallas Cowboy schedule really bad. But we had church at 2:30 in the IB, and children's church was at the old Wayne Myers Auditorium. And so mom and dad would drop me off, and if I could find buddies, we could walk home together and they wouldn't have to come get me. It was a very special day because for the 56th time, I was offered to give my life to Jesus. And it was different that day because somebody said something that completely really changed my life and my future. He was doing some chart on Revelation, Brother Mac. He was doing some chart on Revelations. Scared me to death. And I was just convinced I was going to be beheaded or the big scorpion thing was going to come get me. And so at the end, he asked anybody, you know, who wants to invite Jesus in their life, come down front. Well, I'm like, cool, sounds good. Can escape that, go there, plan. And then he said, but the whole thing is you have to love Jesus with your whole heart. And he said, and you can't love anybody else more than Jesus. So everybody bowed their head, and I'm really thinking about that one. And everybody else raised their hands and went down, and I'm the only kid sitting in the back of the seats. Now I'm not a Christian. And I'm a little concerned because I'm going to have to go home and tell my dad I'm not saved anymore. And I cried all the way home. And dad was sitting in that old sofa. And he said, buddy, what's wrong? And I said, I've got some bad news, dad. He said, what's the news? I said, well, the news is I'm no longer a Christian. He said, what are you talking about? I said, yeah, I can't be a Christian anymore. So he grabbed me and he put me on his lap, and I'm crying. I mean, this is a serious thing for an 11-year-old. I mean, this is serious business. And I said, he said, well, what happened? And I said, well, they gave the altar call, but they said that you have to love Jesus more than anyone, And Dad, I don't love Jesus more than I love you. And so I'm kind of out of the game. And he just sat there and stared at me. And I'm crying because I'm thinking, you know, hell's going to be really hot. And he looked at me and he said, well, son, this is what you do. You keep loving me that way, and one day that love for me will be replaced with the love for Jesus. There's really three things that my dad instilled into my heart. The one was just how much we're to love and how much we're to love God. Second thing that he taught me is probably one of the most important things, is he taught me how to hear God's voice. See, my dad wasn't one of those guys that just came in, came out. He invested into people. He didn't ask how you're doing just to kind of get beyond you to the next person. If he asked it, he was really expecting you to tell him how you're doing. And I said, well, what does God's voice sound like? And he said, well, it sounds like this. God doesn't speak in this audible whatever. He speaks from location. And God's inside of you. So he's going to speak from you, inside of you. And then he said, I said, well, what's it going to sound like? And he told me a story about Samuel. He said, Samuel was around your age, man. And one night, Samuel hears Eli calling him. So Samuel gets up, runs to Eli's house, says, hey, what you need? Now, Eli wasn't necessarily his father, but he was acting and functioning as a father in his life. He said, what do you need me for, sir? And King James says, here am I. And Eli said, I didn't call you. Go back to bed. He goes back to bed, he lays down, and all of a sudden he hears a voice again, runs smack dab into Eli's room and says, did you call me? I was just here. He goes, no, that wasn't me. Goes back, lays back again, and hears the voice again. And so he gets up, and he runs back into the room, and he all of a sudden realizes, this kid might be hearing God. But what was strange is the voice of God sounded like his dad. He didn't run to the other priest. He didn't run to the other room. He didn't run to his, you know, other temple brats that were there. What was inside of him sounded like God. And so the way that my dad taught me how to hear God was to hear his voice, and it'll probably sound like me. And what an incredible, incredible weight of responsibility it is for dads. Because we basically impart that voice to our children. That's what they're going to think God sounds like. So he taught me to love because he was a massive lover and hugger. He taught me really how to hear God's voice because he basically said, here's the key of life. If you want the key of life, this is it. He said, just hear God and try your best to obey him. That's the key to life. Hear him, try your best to obey him. The last thing was he taught me how to pray. And what was interesting about the way he taught me how to pray is my dad had this alarm clock that was that big. And it made the most God-awful sound. And it was so loud, I am sure the entire apartment complex in Maranatha heard that thing. And it all started when Brother Morocco decided he wasn't going to do the 5 o'clock prayer anymore. And so Dad said, I'll do it. And so he got up every morning at 5 a.m., went to the library chapel. People would come in. And what he found was, as he was praying with people that entire hour, but he wasn't getting his own prayer time in. So he moved it back an hour. And at 3:45 in the morning, every morning of my life growing up, that alarm goes blaring. Mom, am I not kidding you? And he didn't snooze, which I'm thankful for. But, you know, because you can imagine that thing going on and on and on. But, yeah, he wake up. But instead of going to the library chapel, he would just go into the living room and get on his knees, and he'd start to pray. And he would pray prayers like this. If he's ever done anything or is involved in anything, if he's doing something, expose it. And I'm like, no, God. Bad prayers there, Dad. He would pray for my future wife. He would pray for my future kids. He would pray for Mom. He would pray for Dennis and Ginger. He'd pray for Mrs. Lindsay. He just prayed for an hour, and it went through the walls to where I'm laying in my bed and I'm hearing him, and I'm like, can you please, God's not deaf, just pray to yourself maybe, you know? But all growing up, that was Dad. And then when he came home from the library chapel, him and my mom would get together, and they would have their morning devotions together. And there never was a time where it was just like, well, we'll just try to figure it out. He used this word, inquire of the Lord. He just constantly used that saying, inquire of the Lord. And he said, we don't inquire a lot. We assume a lot, but we don't inquire a lot. And so I just think that today, thinking about all the amazing things and all the amazing lives that he's touched and been a part of, been part of this institution and other organizations, the three nuggets that I think have been burnt and edged into my soul is that we got to stop playing teams of us against them and realize God loves everybody. And we just got to flat out love people. And we've got to be able to be big enough to not only hear God, but do what he says. And I think to honor Dad, it would be to also talk about his prayer life, because that was constant. And it's crazy because he would pray about the most ridiculous stuff, and it's like easy stuff, but he would always inquire of the Lord. And I think what he taught me was is that God will be as real as you make him. And if you don't involve him in your life, in your everyday life, and then you want him just to swoop down, you're missing out on a whole engagement with God that could be life-changing. So my dad, he loved every one of y'all. And he especially loved Dr. Dennis Lindsay. Prayed for you too, sir. But he didn't pray the prayers like he prayed for me. never said that for some reason. But he sure did with me. But we've asked Dr. Lindsay and then Golan and then Dr. Peter Burnett to share some words and their thoughts of Dad. So, Doctor, would you like to come on up? Yeah, absolutely.
Thank you, Kevin. You know what? It's amazing how the Lord anoints our children. I mean, Randy and I would come down every week, next door. Do that every week. Get rid of some of our frustrations, you know. Our children or our sons were a little bit small, so they just watched us. You know, now I don't have to do that anymore, and they do. They are doing this crazy stuff, you know. It's interesting to see how the Lord anoints your children. I don't know all the reasons. I've raised my three kids in the same house, the same church, by the same mothers. And they're different as night and day, and yet they love the Lord. I mean, it's pretty amazing. I had a few thoughts over the last few weeks when I found out the news. We were over in Europe, in Israel, and I put them down. Some things to share with you. And then this morning, the Lord kind of changed my schedule. Kind of interesting. I started the book of Ecclesiastes this morning. Anyway, we just came in from Germany, and I'm not sure what time it is today. I was up at 3 o'clock this morning, and 4 o'clock, and then 5 o'clock, and 6 o'clock, and I finally got up at 6. But while we were in Germany, we visited Ludendorff Palace, Herrenhemische Palace, Neuschwanstein Castle. And if you know anything about the person that built those, he was a bit crazy. King Ludwig II, a fairy tale king. And we visited those three places. The first one is so gilded with gold. It's just unbelievable, this palace that we went through. If you've never seen it, if you look it on the web, you cannot believe it, and especially walking through it and seeing the marvelous design of this little palace. And then we went to the second palace, and it's even more grander. It's just unbelievable, those two palaces. And then we finally went to the castle, the Disneyland, you know, Cinderella castle. It was a beautiful day, gorgeous day. We went up there to go in, and we had tickets to get in. We had them for a long time, and they said, no, we're closed today. The fear virus, you know what I'm talking about. We'd been there several times before, but again, several of the tour groups, the Lord just made way for them to get in for free. I mean, that's crazy. But my point is, Ecclesiastes is written by an author in a midlife crisis, kind of like this gentleman that built these three castles, because they don't know how he died, but right there is a little lake by the castle. He just went off. 39 years of age, or was it 40 years of age? It's just unbelievable. One castle he built, but he never lived in. Another one, only 10 days. And these places are amazing. Well, the teacher of Ecclesiastes' assessment of life, after trying, testing, and tasting everything life had to offer, states that life is meaningless like chasing the wind. Chapter 1, verse 14. The teacher had learned the true satisfaction and meaning in life could not be found in the paths of the world typically pursues, knowledge and popularity and money and pleasure, or even in work. The teacher concludes that real satisfaction comes only from knowing God and obeying his commandments. Without God at the center of our lives, we will end up like the teacher, empty and cynical. This is in the book of Ecclesiastes. While the tone of the book is largely negative and pessimistic, Ecclesiastes also offers us some important insights and wisdom. For example, chapter 2, verse 24, true enjoyment in life comes as we follow God's guidelines and stay connected to Him. Chapter 3, satisfaction in life is a gift from God. Chapter 9, all our days are in God's hands. Chapter 3, verse 1 through 8, God's timing is perfect. Think about Randy. God's timing is perfect. And then the bottom line, fear God and obey his commandments, for this is the duty of every person. Chapter 12. So the lesson is clear. The pursuits of the world are empty without the vital living relationship with our Lord God. Okay, we all know that, right? Well, some things that come to my mind concerning Randy is our friendship. It's pretty amazing. I think of the story about Moses when God asked him to do something and he says no. God says no. And Moses, no, no, no. And finally, I think the Lord gets a little angry with him and hits him over the head and wakes him up. And finally, he says, I can't do this. Well, I'll give you people and put around you. And I still remember in 1984, the board meeting, Mom surprised everybody. Mom was not good at keeping surprises, but she surprised us all. I was there. I've been praying about who's going to follow me. And I know that y'all all have the ideas, talking to the board members, because they had already been saying who's going to be following in Mom's footsteps. And Mom said, I want you to elect Dennis Lindsay as president of the ministry. And I remember, boy, it was silence. You could hear a pin drop. And I was a bit silent. And I'm thinking, what in the world? I've never been trained for this. But apparently Mom had been praying. And a little later, I had a little devotional with the Lord, and the Lord says, Dennis, you haven't been trained. And as long as you remember, I'll put some people around you. I'll put an Aaron, I'll put a Joshua, I'll put a Caleb that will hold up your arms. And you know what? Randy is one of those people that the Lord has given me how many years? 30 plus years? And how much he did for me? I mean, it's amazing what all he has done for me. I'm thinking about when I was working on my dissertation and I finally gave up when Mom was getting ready to go to heaven. I could not do the documentation, even though it was my favorite subject, a biblical view of creation. And I finally said, I just can't do this. The requirements for documentation was enormous, and I had to do it every 2 weeks. So finally, I just gave up. A couple of years later, you know, after Mom goes to heaven, I'm back up ORU, and I bump into my dean of the graduate school, and I said, you know, I think I could finish. I had a big smile on my mouth. You know, if you extend my 5 years is up, I know that. And he says, well, I'll check on it. And he comes back the next day and says, you know what? This is the second time in the history of ORU. We're going to make an exception and extend you. And I had a big joy in my heart. Oh, wow, because I've already been working a couple years on it, even though the time is long since gone. But they said, you can't do it on a biblical view of creation. Oh, I didn't say anything, but I'm thinking, what in the world? We want you to do it on the history of Christ for the Nations Institute and its impact upon the world. Kind of shocked me. And I'm thinking, wow, maybe I can do that. And when Randy heard that, Dennis, I'll go in and help you document everything about this dissertation. And Randy did for the next year or so, putting all this stuff, because we had all the documentation there here in the archives, and he worked on that dissertation night and day, documenting all the stories of this ministry. That's the Randy that I knew. I remember when he came to me one evening and he says, your mom has asked us to consider going and helping to start the school down in Jamaica, and I'm not sure that we've never done that before. And what do you think, Dennis? And I said, you know what? I've learned something from my mom. Even though I didn't want to do different things, the Lord showed me, if you take a step of faith out of your boat of comfort, Dennis, watch what the Lord will do. And I've written a new book, 77 Supernatural Surprises from Jehovah Sneaky. And I share these stories when Mom asked me to do something and I did not want to do it. And I went ahead and did it and watched what happened. And Randy says, okay, that's the Lord. And they went to Jamaica and started our first Bible school down there. The thing that we sent out to all the staff when Randy graduated to heaven, it's just amazing all the different things that he's done. Now, Kevin told you a little bit, but it's far greater than that. How Randy has blessed Christ for the Nations, blessed me, our family, it's enormous. I don't know what Terry was doing all the time he was helping us for so many things and say, Randy, when are you going to go to bed? And Randy would stay up and work time and time again. I learned this, Proverbs 27:17, as iron sharpens iron, so a friend sharpens a friend. And that's what Randy did in my behalf. He sharpened me time and time again. I think back to this book that I just mentioned. It's a story of my life here at Christ of the Nations, all the surprises. And Randy decided he wanted to read a little bit, or I said, Randy, read this, and what do you think? He says, I want to help you on this thing. He went through chapter by chapter by chapter and made it into a very readable doctrine, a readable book. I mean, the way Randy has been gifted to write things, he has blessed me time and time again with letters and things like that. So this book, when I finally finished it and I thought, well, I needed to figure out who I'm going to dedicate it to. Do I do it to who? And I thought about Randy. And so a month or two ago, I forget, when I finally decided, Randy, I'm going to do this. But I didn't tell Randy. And so I got the documentation, did it, a dedication to Randy. And I put it at the end of the book. And I was going to surprise Randy when I came back. And we're printing it even right now. So when we come back from Europe, it's going to be a surprise. He doesn't know this. I did tell Terry. I said, Terry, this is a secret. Don't tell him. Now, I don't know. I don't think she did. But I believe he knows by now, even though I didn't get a chance to tell him here on planet Earth. I think somebody, some angel, maybe have told him that it's dedicated to him. And I just wanted to read that to you. The little, right at the very end. It's kind of big, isn't it? It's big print for people that can't see very good. Okay, dedication. As much as I enjoyed authoring this book, along with all those who assisted me in producing the history and highlights of my blessed life, there's one individual I must recognize and honor. It is my longtime good and precious friend, Randy Dell. Randy has assisted me in multiple documents over the past 40 years, providing me with additions that have highlighted my writings, especially throughout this book. Therefore, I want to give honor where honor is due, thanking him for his loving service in the production of this volume. Therefore, my autobiography is dedicated to my longtime friend, Randy Dell. Randy, his wife Terry, and her son Kevin have all served at CFN, and now their grandson Jason is attending Christ for the Nations. May the Lord bless Randy and his family as they continue to serve him at Christ for the Nations. I didn't get to tell him and surprise him, but I know he knows. This is the Randy that I know all the years. He has been an Aaron, a Joshua, Caleb, held up my hands time and time again, helping me with 101 things. And it's an honor to be here with all of y'all, just celebrating this man of God who was brought to Christ for the Nations and helped us to carry on this ministry. You know, just coming back from Israel, I have a new love for Israel, and it has been there 35 times, and that this probably was the best one, if not the best, ever. Something happened there. The Lord's coming back soon, and I just want to get you, if you don't know what's going on in Israel, you better get connected, because you won't know what the Lord's doing in the rest of the world until you understand what he's doing in Israel. So I bless the Lord. I bless Randy Dilp. I bless Terry, his whole family. Oh, my goodness. I could sit up here and talk forever. My wife's not here to kick me to sit down, so I'm going to pass it back on to my son, Golan. So keep it short, according to your mom.
All right, thank you. Chris, is this fine to be here with online? Okay. All right, thank you. It's an honor to be able to share about Mr. Dell. Thank you guys for that. What I'm going to be sharing is obviously has a lot to do with Christ for the Nations, as that's where me and him connected, and that's where we've been this whole time. So I know that the family's obviously going to be missing him more than anything, but I'd say the next is going to be Christ for the Nations. We'll be missing him the second most, I believe, for all that he was to us and did here at Christ for the Nations. You know, there are a number of men and women that came through Christ for the Nations that were kind of watchmen on the wall for this place, that took care of this place. There's Mr. Hatcher, Bozarth, Carol Thompson, John Holler, Eric Belcher, and Mr. Delp was one of those that was always here to help this place, and that's why we're still here. That's one of the reasons, is because of him. And so we're blessed by that. My story with Mr. Delp begins from the first time I really remember is whenever I went over to your house when I was a kid, And I remember it because I was a little bit embarrassed. What had happened is I turned the channel on the TV. I believe it was the Cowboys, I'm not sure. And I think I'd put on a video game to play that you had. And so my parents reprimanded me, you don't ever touch someone's stuff without asking them. But I also realized now it's because the Cowboys were on and you don't turn that off on the Delps. That's one of the most important things. So I didn't know it at the time. I just knew. I just remember that time I was at your place. That's where I first remember getting to know you guys. The next was after I finished high school. I had just broken up with my first girlfriend ever, and going through a difficult time. And they took me in. I went up to Minnesota for a number of months, where I went up and helped Kevin with painting houses. And we were taping the houses, and it was waking up 5 a.m. It was difficult living in the same room with 8 or 10 other guys in one shower, 12 guys. It was difficult. But that was a time that I was going through hell, it seemed like. Never been through a breakup before. And so they took me in up there, and he was kind of like a father to me. I was only 18, and so he was writing a book, and he actually allowed me to kind of go through and proof it, which at the time I just thought, wow, that's pretty amazing. I was at that time where I didn't feel a lot of people believed in me. I was just hadn't done a lot of good yet, and so I was always in trouble. And so Mr. Delp and Kevin kind of made me feel like I was actually something and took care of me and talked life into me. And so that was the second time. And then I made another mistake up there where I had to be sent back down to Dallas. But through all my difficulties, they were some of the few that actually made me feel like, you know what, I'm all right. I'm gonna do all right in this life. Then the next where it began my process with him here working at Christ for the Nations, he came in as the business manager in 2010, I believe. There was two people. I came in out of college not really knowing what I'm doing, placed in the business office. Mr. McMenemy and Mr. Delp were the two older men that kind of fathered me and helped me grow into the position that I am now. And so at that time, I could go to him for anything, and he would walk me through certain situations, hiring people, releasing. He was the one that spoke a lot into my life and just helping me grow, coming right out of college and not knowing exactly what I was doing. He always spoke life over me, always encouraged me, always supported me in the vision the Lord was slowly putting in my heart. People would say, you need to have that vision now, you need to write it down, you need to know what he's saying. And he would always say, just be patient, the Lord's working. It takes time, and he would just help encourage me through that. And I'll never forget what he's been to me during this time. I didn't even believe in myself for the most part, most of the time. I was always giving my authority away, whatever I had to do to other people, always passing that off. Mr. Delp was one person that, you know, most people would take that and run with it. And they would try to take over and run their own show and build their own kingdom. And Mr. Delp never did that. He was faithful in serving and loving. And you know you could always trust him because he was here to serve and not to take over and run his own thing. That showed the integrity and the godly character in his life that a lot of people don't have. That was proof that he was not here for himself, but he was here for my parents, Christ for the Nations, and for the Lord. As we always say, this is the Lord's place. It's not ours. It's not anyone else's. And he served the Lord's place faithfully. People are usually either spiritual, over spiritual, or business type, but he had a balance that he could do both. We didn't have a lot of those people here, but he had that balance right down the middle where you could go to him for prayer. He would always go to the Lord to get a decision. Or business-wise, anything I wanted to go into, Google wasn't as, it was big back then, but he was kind of the Google at the time that would come and help me. Not everyone you could place in almost any position, and he had a lot of positions here, and feel comfortable that they could get the job done, but Mr. Delp had that ability. He was multifaceted. The most important thing I feel, and I'm sure my dad does as well, is his loyalty to us, to Cif and I. Several times, Cif and I had gone through possible takeovers and just transitioned disunity in the leadership. Mr. Delp was never a part of any of those. But he always made it clear that he was loyal to Gordon and Frieda's vision for Christ for the Nations. To me, the biggest blessing that I've seen through the 10, 12 years that I've worked with him was these last 2 years. If nothing else, what he did in the legal part in dealing with the bylaws, with the issues that happened just during COVID, of just some transition that almost happened. He helped in the board meetings and with the attorneys, all that we had to deal with in these last 2 years to be where we are presently right now. He and Kiplin are the two people that helped my dad and us with all those issues and the legalities and the bylaws transitioning. It was him and Ms. and Kiplin that did the most to help us in our present position. There are people that lead, people that live their life with their vision and dreams they feel the Lord has given them. People these days feel, Lord's given me this in my heart. I need to fulfill it. I need to do this. I need to build my own kingdom. Everybody has their agenda, what they want to do. And you don't see any more people just lay it all down, die to themselves, run with someone else's vision. That doesn't happen anymore. But Mr. Delp actually did that. He probably maybe had vision for things. He probably had dreams to do stuff. But he did something you don't see most people do. Jesus came to serve and not be served. He came to run his Father's vision. Mr. Delp did the same thing. He gave up his life. And sometimes I feel to apologize, even though probably you guys don't mind. I wondered sometimes if he did too much for C4I and sometimes didn't do enough for the family. I don't know if that was the case or not. But he did went above and beyond for Christ for the Nations here. And so I just want you guys to know as this family that we are grateful for that. We don't take that for granted at all. And so, yeah, we're gonna miss him here. There's those that die to everything, lay their lives down, and serve another, someone else's vision. Mr. Dope was one of those. The last thing, and I believe this is one of the most important foundations that I speak of here at CF&I when I talk to the students, the alumni, the staff. There are a lot of people in this world like Mr. Dope who can talk a lot and minister and say they are followers of Jesus. Those who can get up on stage and speak easily and walk in the gifts, those who have high positions and authority. You see that everywhere. But most of them cannot do what he did so well, and that was actually walk out the fruit, walk out what he talked, walk out the fruit of Jesus and look like Jesus. He actually looked like him on a day-to-day basis. It's one of the hardest things for us Christians to do is be Christ-like. We say we're Christians, but yet we don't look like Christ and just walking out the fruit. And day to day, he did that. He was kind and gracious all the time, compassionate, gentle in his responses, sweet-spirited, loving and forgiving of those who spoke ill of him. He wouldn't gossip, and if someone was, he would redirect it by speaking a kind word about the person. But that's one of the biggest things I believe to anybody that says they're a follower of Christ. If you can't look like Jesus, if you don't walk out the fruit, but you can do all the other, the gifts, and you can preach, and you can stand up in front of a crowd, it's all useless. But Mr. Delp, he did that. He walked out the fruit, the love, unconditional love. I'd heard plenty of people talk about him, but he wouldn't, it didn't bother him, just like Jesus was up on the cross. And they beat him down, but he says, forgive them, they don't know what they're doing. It's the same thing Mr. Delp said to me a couple times on certain people. It just didn't matter. And that's the same way we're all supposed to be doing as well. And he laid that example to us. So that's something that sticks closely to me. And now when I think of it, he's up there dancing away with Jesus, with my grandma and grandpa, with some other of your family. He's up there having a good time. I mean, that's where I would like to be right now, but he's there enjoying the life that we're supposed to be living right now, but we can't until we go home. Because we're in right now, need to follow his example and be a light to the rest of this world. And that's what we're doing at Christ for the Nations. And so he helped us to be where we are presently here at CF&I in transforming lives for Jesus because of a lot of what he did. So that's a big thank you to him and to you guys for allowing him to do all that he did spending time with Christ for the Nations. Thank you very much.
I don't know if you need to turn the light up a little bit for me. I bring a bag. Okay. Am I okay here? I bring a flag from Jamaica. Never done this before. I'm actually gonna put it over my shoulder. I stand here humbly to represent all those who have benefited from the life and ministry of Dr. Randy Delp in Jamaica and the Caribbean. I was a 17-year-old, skinny, redhead, Jamaican kid on work scholarship when I attended his class. The Spiritual Man absolutely changed my life. That was 1984. I returned to Jamaica in 1985. I wrote him a letter in Yalas, and I said, we need help in Jamaica. We need help for the transformation of our nation. He responded, and he brought an outreach team to Jamaica in 1986. It was so transformative, my wife was on the trip. And that year, the work started for Caribbean Christ for the Nations to be started in Montego Bay. That school started, and Randy and Terry were the first directors, the pioneer of the school. I was still a skinny redhead kid. I was part of that team. The school closed in 2001, but over 500 students graduated from that school. Today they are husbands, wives, pastors, leaders, grandparents. And he was one of those persons who were also a part of our marriage. We had a marriage officer in Jamaica, and Randy stood when Betty and I got married in 1987. And a few months later, he stood with me when I was ordained into the ministry in 1987. In fact, Betty and I was thinking, Sister Terry and Kevin, that really for every significant milestone in our ministry and life, there's a hand of Randy Delp. He's been a part of it for the last several years. He supported the call of God for us to start a Christian university in Jamaica, Emmanuel Caribbean University. And the last board meeting was in April, and he conducted it on his bed. He wanted to be a part of every board meeting right up to the very end. He was a chairman of our board, and we honored him. Randy Dev was a man with a vision. He loved God. Today, I bring this plaque of Jamaica with me, and I will give it to you today for you and the family. I want you to hear what some of the graduates that he taught in Jamaica said. This is Pastor Raymond Graham. He graduated in 87. He was from that very first class. Today, he's a pastor of a church in Mandeville and one of the leaders in the nation. He said, I always remember him teaching us that marriage is a total commitment of a conditional plan or promise based not on emotion, but of a total commitment to another imperfect person as long as you both shall live. Remember, Hopi Apollone was one of the first group of students. She said, he was a beautiful soul. He fought a good fight. He kept the faith. He finished the course. Then there was a young man who came from Haiti. His name was Kendall Stevenson. He's now Dr. Kendall Stevenson. He's the president of Lincolnson Global Christian University. He said Brother Delp has transitioned to heaven. He has also joined the ranks of the immortals and is now a member of the Clouds of Witnesses. Personally, Dr. Delp was positively and optimistically impacted my life in the very, like the very first day. Tuesday, he remembered the day. Tuesday, September the 1st, 1987. He said, when I set foot inside the chapel of CCFNI on the hills at Reading, St. James. Until now, Kendall Stevenson said, I vividly remember some of his profound thought-provoking teachings. Think basic, think big, think positive. He said, the Debs are a gift from the kingdom of God to humanity. He cannot begin to fathom how much Randy Delp is in heaven, even now, rejoicing before God, our Maker. There's a scripture I want to read as I close. And one of the reasons why I bring this flag, because I believe that many people think of many other places when they think of missions. Many people fly over the Caribbean and go to many other places. And yes, we have nice white sand beaches, but Randy never forgot the need. He never forgot the people that needed to be developed, the people that needed to learn, the people that needed to be invested in. And all these 40 years is always returned to create opportunities. One of the greatest things you can give someone, it's not money, it's an opportunity. And he did that. And this scripture says in Revelation 21, but I saw no temple in it. This is in the New Jerusalem. For the Lord God Almighty and the Lamb are its temple. And the city had no need of the sun. I think I need of the light, but the city had no need of the sun or of the moon to shine in it. For the glory of God illuminated it. He said, the Lamb is the light. And the nations of those who are saved shall walk in its light. And the kings of the earth bring their glory and honor into it. I believe that there is a glory of God that every nation represents. And I believe that when the New Jerusalem come, there's going to be a company of people out of Jamaica and out of the Caribbean that's going to enter that New Jerusalem because of the ministry of Randy Delp.
Being Randy's niece was such an honor and a privilege for me. I remember when it came time to get married, there was no question in my mind at that point who I was going to have marry me to my husband. And I called and I said, would you conduct my wedding ceremony for me? And he said, I would be honored. And I'll never forget that day. He was up there talking, and he had the most amazing way of making things so personal, just making it just unique to you. And I'll never forget him saying, and at some point in the ceremony, he said, and we're looking forward to the little Dales and the little Sherrys running around. And he talked about how God was going to make our quiver full, and I didn't know what a quiver was. And I said, okay, I don't know what that is, but okay. But God did give me two precious boys. And that's all the fullness I need in the quiver. heaven's sweeter today because he's there, and I'm looking forward to the day that I get to go wrap my arms around him and hug his neck again and tell him how honored I am to still have him as my Uncle Randy. Today, he's more alive than he's ever been. I'm thankful that we'll get to see him again. He was just about to cross the River Jordan, prepared to make the journey for so long. It seemed his heart already made the crossing. He said, "I hear the distant sounds of home." He had always kept the faith and fought the good fight and ran the course with joy of heaven's race. And as we gather round him with great sorrow, he spoke with love and rapture on his face. "I'll be present in the presence of the angels. I will join the choirs of millions as they sing. To be absent from this body is to live eternally. I'll be present in the presence of the King. When at last it's time to leave this earth behind me, and I say goodbye to heartache, grief, and sin, oh, don't think for a moment that it's over. I'll be more alive than I have ever. Of the angels, I will join the choirs of millions as they sing. To be absent from this body is to live eternally. I'll be present in the presence of the King. To be absent from this body is to live eternally. I'll be present in the presence of the King." I'll see you soon.
My name's Reagan, if we haven't met. I was his granddaughter. I wrote a little something. I first just wanted to say that I think it's really beautiful how when everybody who's chosen to talk about him has also brought up Jesus. It's really sweet how the two seem to go hand in hand. And I think he would like that a lot. Finding a way to summarize what to say about my papa, it seems nearly impossible. I could talk about him for days. I figured that today I would show you how I saw him. Not as Randy Delp, or Dr. Delp, or whoever he was to you, but as my papa. There was no one else who I loved quite in the specific way that I loved him. He filled that grandfather-father role so perfectly. He was the person who would go get me ice cream at midnight or take me to the store when I wanted something completely useless or random, or, you know, never fail to pick me up anywhere if I needed a last-minute ride. And, you know, I can't even count how many times he probably revised all my papers and sat with me trying to teach me math. But he always showed up to every single production or game that I ever had. He was just constantly there. He was filled with love all the time. I knew him as the cuddly teddy bear with huge hands who would always have your leftovers if you couldn't finish them. And I seemed to keep describing him to people that didn't know him as if you could personify the sun. That's how I saw my papa. He was truly the image of God's love. And I oddly feel closer to Jesus since he left. I don't know what that's about, but it's funny because the day that my papa passed, I was in a nail salon in Pasadena, California, getting birthday nails for my 19th. That was 2 days after. And I didn't know, but I couldn't stop talking about him. I don't know why I couldn't shut up that day, but I was with my friend, and I was just talking about everything, about his memories and things I wanted to do to honor him and tattoos I should get for him. But most importantly, that was the first time that I felt at true peace with the idea of him passing. And then he left us a couple hours later. So feels like he waited until I was okay. Cancer, excuse my language, can kiss my ass. Amen. And is not an easy battle. And seeing him in pain and barely able to stay awake longer than a sentence was something that I realized I wanted him free of. You know, I came to the conclusion that I would rather have him joyful and pain-free in heaven than selfishly on earth holding on to the idea that he might get better. Now, that doesn't mean that I don't miss him with every breath that I take and every minute that passes by. But I take great comfort in knowing that I'll one day be greeted with him shouting, Ray Ray, and giving me one of his hugs. I promise that while I'm still on earth, I'll live to make him proud. I love you.
All right, I'm on talk now. And I apologize if I do a worse job of keeping it together than you did, Ray. If you're wondering how my day's going, I ripped my pants when I sat down, so. SpongeBob warned me when I was a kid, I didn't listen. As a heads up, I haven't really been able to get through this in the times that I put it together. I'm Mason. Like I said earlier, I'm the grandson, and in a lot of ways, I'm the son. To be honest, I put off writing this. I ended up finishing it about 2 o'clock in the morning last night. I knew I wanted to say something, but exactly what, I wasn't so sure. I had a problem. Problem was, how do I sum up a lifetime of experiences and relationship in merely a few words and pages? Felt like a futile effort. Did the best I could, though. So, Papa was not just a grandfather to me. He was a million things, somehow all packaged into one person. He was a pioneer for our family. He was a bastion of wisdom. And he was always a creative problem solver. He was a soft landing for failures. He was life's traffic director. And he was a valiant protector of all the things that he loved. He exemplified virtue and well and truly did his best to make the decisions that benefited others first. To me, he was a living superhero. But even those words somehow still feel paltry compared to what it was like living with him. There was never a time when he didn't have a good answer to a problem that I had. He was the advice giver. He wasn't in the business of telling me what option to choose. Instead, he helped me find the answer on my own, gently guiding me with the right questions. But, yeah, there was an exception to that one. Whenever it came to Amber, he told me what to do. He said, "You stick with that girl, Mason. Don't you mess that up." I listened to him there. About the only time we ever differed was theologically. We saw that as a fantastic thing, though. He gave me new perspectives, and on the occasion when I dropped the odd pearl, he made sure to encourage me too. He knew so much more than I did, but he always handled my stubborn, youthful assurance with love and with grace. Speaking of which, if you didn't know, that's really what it's like to live in the Delp household. It is, in essence, an ongoing theological debate that can be paused, picked up at any time, lasts for hours. It was in many ways our love language. And while it may have gotten loud, there was never a lack of love, and there was never anger. Sometimes I'd stay for the full conversation, but I'd normally drop out somewhere between the first 30 minutes to an hour, leaving Dad and Pop to continue that conversation. Wish I'd stayed longer now. Another thing that represents what it was like to live with Papa was music. But not really in the way that you think it is. You see, Papa didn't listen to music all that much on his own, but there were two things that he did all the time, and that was sing and dance. Not in a good way. Memo says he used to be a good singer, but one day before I can even remember, he developed a, let's say, technique. And, man, he loved it. But no matter how it sounded, he always made sure to sing loud and proud, often making up songs about whatever it was he was doing, dishes, walking, all the stuff. And if he really got into it, which he always did, the dancing would begin. Not to the rhythm of whatever he was singing, mind you, but he tried to sell it. I remember he'd walk around, he'd find Mamaw, grab her hand, try and dance with her. But whatever he was doing was always impossible to follow. He knew that, though. He was just trying to make her and us laugh, which that was another thing that he was so good at. He had a way with jokes. Again, not in the way that you think, because he rarely got through the joke. most times laughing uncontrollably before he could deliver the punchline. Or he'd tell the joke and then immediately burst into laughter. And that was the part that normally made us laugh. It was never the joke. It was never the joke. He was great at cheering people up. That normally included a joke or two. What I'd give for a joke now, huh? And while he was many things to me and to many other people, there was one thing that I get the pleasure of remembering him as, and that's being my ice cream buddy. Growing up, that's what he called me. That's what I called him. And that's because we shared a mutual love for ice cream, a love that he found every excuse to indulge in, but he never did that alone, because I was always with him, either sitting in his lap when I was younger or in the chair next to him when I got older with a bowl of my own. It was such a simple thing, but I wouldn't trade that for anything. Funny enough, when Amber came into our lives, we also became buddies for whatever it is she was cooking that day. And he loved her cooking. The last few times he was with us are now precious memories to me. I remember in those last few days, we'd have family worship at night with just our voices and my guitar missing a string. I think I went like 2 weeks without changing it. I remember the last word that he'd ever spoke to me. So lucky. He told me, "I love you." That was the last thing he ever said to me. And now, standing here at the end of his life, I find it strange that my earliest memory is of him We've got a picture of it somewhere, making a snowman with me in Minnesota. I don't know how I remember it. I was so young, but man, I'm glad I do. I'm also glad I remember all those days playing kickball in the backyard. And the day when he and I were swimming in the pool and I heard a tornado siren and thought that was the trumpet signifying Jesus' return. Gosh, I remember he was swimming, he heard it, and I went. He laughed. I'm glad I still have all the books you wrote, Papa, especially the one you wrote about me and Ray. For those who don't know, I've had the pleasure of living with Papa most of my life, and I had the honor of getting to take care of him in his last days. But we were really counting on a miracle with him. I'd even go so far as to say that we were convinced it happened. Papa was in the same boat, and he was so sure he'd be healed. So today's a little surreal. But I remember the words of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, even if he does not. And even though you didn't heal him, Lord, my response is the same. In all this, may the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight, Lord, my rock and my redeemer. We have a slideshow of pictures of Papa up there. And before the service started, we were playing two songs along with it, and both are called Holy Ground. Funny enough, perhaps I need to add an addendum to what my definition of holy ground is to include this. The lyric in the song says, Lord, let every burning heart be holy ground, but Lord, let my broken heart be holy ground as well. Papa, I love you so much. And I miss you. Thanks for helping raise me. I wish you could have seen Ray and I graduate college, get married, have kids, all the other stuff. I wish I had your advice to count on, but I'm leaning on God. I'm sure you're in heaven. Now, with all the answers about the true age of the earth, whether Noah's flood was metaphorical, local, or global, or whether penal substitutionary atonement's right to believe or not, all the other stuff, I'm sure you're singing off-key, dancing off-rhythm, probably with a bowl of ice cream in your hand. So just save a bowl for me, and I'll see you when I get up there. I think now the Delps are coming up. Or just the sun.
Well, you got kind of a little taste of what it's like to be in my home. I'm proud of these kiddos. I'm proud of my mama. But I'm really proud of him. We're just going to sing one more song, right? Is that right? We're just going to sing one more song, and then we'll let you guys get out of here. But we do want to thank you one more time for coming. Can't tell you how much we appreciate it. It's been special to share that with y'all today.
Oh Lord, my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the works thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power. power throughout the universe displayed, and then sings my soul, my Savior God. How great thou art. How great. Then I shall bow in humble adoration and then proclaim my God, how great thou art. Then sing
We're going to close in prayer. Before we do that, I just want to say to the Delp family how much I love you, how precious, dear you are to me. And I love you because you love me. And my second pop loved me too. And about a month before he passed and went with Jesus, he said the most powerful and precious prayer blessing over me and Kevin. And so it's my honor to say a prayer blessing over you today. Would you join me in prayer? Heavenly Father, we thank you today. We thank you for gracing this planet with a tremendous man of God, Randy Dell. And God, we celebrate the fact that he is living in a revelation that we can only imagine. But Lord, the pain is real, the loss is real. And so I just ask, Holy Spirit, that you would be what you are called, the comforter, and that you would continue to comfort and strengthen hearts over the next coming days and months and years. And God, I pray that all of us would take with us today the idea and the thought and the challenge that was the life of Randy Delp. No doubt you said, well done, thy good and faithful servant. And so, God, may that also be our same passion and our same goal. And Lord, we give you all the glory, all the honor, and all the praise in your precious name. Amen. For when I understand at Lee University, they do a benediction. I wouldn't know because I graduated from CFNI. There you go. I believe the words are up here. We're going to say it together. Let the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. For those of you that are invited to the private reception, there should be a map up here telling you how to get there, and we would appreciate that. Once again, on behalf of the family, thank you so much for coming today. The service is over. God bless.